The following program contains graphic material, including offensive language. Viewer discretion is advised.
Rock, rock, rockin' Nicole. Yeah. Rock, rock, rockin' Nicole. Rock, rock, rockin' Nicole. Oh, once she grabs, she won't let go. Rock, rock, rockin' Nicole. Rock, rock, rockin' Nicole.
None of that soft stuff.
Rock, rock, rockin' Nicole.
None of that heavy metal stuff.
Rock, rock, rockin' Nicole.
Just a little bit of jazz.
Rock, rock, rockin' Nicole.
What do
you think? Just I like love that. That was great. Thank you.
The GOP's remaining sanity is rapidly declining. But amid all the inanity, I've found a silver lining. They're riding our campaign ads for us with their obvious hypocrisy. Like begging for a border deal in lockstep chorus, then killing it willfully. We don't need to create persuasive output. Just sit back and watch them shoot themselves in the foot. The stupidity continues to floor us as they're writing our campaign ads for us. They're designing great campaign ads for us by attacking reproductive rights, which drives turnout to turnout sexists who abhor us and legislate like troglodytes. Then, as if young women weren't already miffed, they pile on with vile attacks on Taylor Swift. So young folks almost adore us as they keep writing our campaign ads for us. The party that was all about law and order defends an insurrectionist and document hoarder. As their idol grows more convictable, they babble about who's indictable. When they're so sleazy, making fun of them, ZZ. For our campaign ads, we just go see as they bicker, dicker, and fret. And they say they wish they had a Nancy Pelosi, while George Santos says, miss me yet? And with their clear adherence to you know who, turning their words against him is a cinch to do, without even needing a thesaurus, as they write our campaign ads for us. If the GOP remains so insanely zany, they'll fulfill the wish of Liz Cheney and die out like the brontosaurus, while writing our campaign ads for us. Till we say, eek ads, throw out your notepads, they're writing our campaign ads for us.
Woo! We don't turn the video off just yet, so I want to give you a very quick reminder that if you enjoy these weekly videos, I hope you consider supporting me on my Patreon. For as little as $2 a month, which is less than half the cost of a latte, you'll get bonus content as well as the satisfaction that you're helping me continue to put these videos out, helping everybody laugh at the news.
Yes,
and these
yes,
days,
yes,
don't
yes.
we all need more laughter?
Yeah,
thanks.
Lauren Mayer, everybody, getting us started today. And actually, that's one she put out, a couple of weeks ago. But it worked for today, because I'm so excited for today's guest. Let me just tell you, I've been engrossed in this new book. As you can see, all the stickies on it. We're not going to have a chance to talk about all of them. But I am thrilled hold on. I got to get our shot. What? Oh, I see what I did. Hold on one second, Rachel. I guess I need to do it this way. I'm getting our shots set. See, this is the problem when you're your own producer and everything else. I had the shot set up before, and now there she is. Okay, so Rachel is huge on my screen. I just gotta make it a little let me just bring her on here so you can see what I'm talking about. Rachel Bitecofer is back. Rachel, thank you so much for being here today. And congratulations on the book. The new book is called Hit 'em Where It Hurts. I make it in the camera. How to Save Democracy by Beating Republicans at Their Own Game. And it's just been out a week or two, right?
Yeah, it's just fresh off the press. And I got to say, I like seeing people's indexed versions. You know what I mean? You should get a copy of that up on Twitter so I can RT it.
There's
a lot of people underlining that, you know, people all the way up from the DNC chair all the way down to the folks that are listening to the show. And I'm really glad that it's worked out. It was a team effort. Penguin Random House crown, and my editor, my lit agent, and then my co-author helped me produce something that people can use right now to help us save democracy. And I'm really, really happy.
Well, it's so good. First of all, it is engrossing. It reads really easy, just like listening to you talk. You know, you joined me on the show. It's got to be about a year ago now. And that's still one of my favorite shows. I love talking to you because you speak plain English. You say what you mean. You don't beat around the bush. You're not afraid to use, you know, bad words as if we're, you know, I go back to my kid years and think sticks and stones can break my bones, but words can never hurt you. I mean, they can, depending on how you use them. That's why we need to use them meaningfully. And you talk about the messaging, and this has been a problem with the Democratic Party for as long as I can remember. I used to say the Democrats need better bumper sticker writers. They need better, you know, and we have good people on our side. I just don't understand why the candidates and our elected officials don't practice more creativity. And this is where you come in. So the book, it gives some real boots on the ground advice to candidates, to activists, to concerned citizens who just want to make sure that Donald Trump doesn't get back in the White House. And you give us some really good tools. So I want to go through some of them with you today as we talk about the book. First of all, you start out with a bit of history. I mean, you go through sort of how we got here. You know, was it always this way? Were Democrats always so uncreative with their messaging?
Yeah, no, I'm really glad you're asking about that, because what people need to understand about this work, the book is the work, right? It's not about tinkering up in the trees of Democratic messaging. It's arguing, look, we have the wrong soil, the wrong tree. We got to uproot it, replant, total scrap-a-doodle, right? And the reason is that front half of the book where you kind of talk, where you said I talk about the history, because I lay out for folks why, like, I mean, there was an asymmetry because Republicans started to get kind of, you know, Roger Stoney about politics back in the 70s. You know, they had some, the Willie Horton ad was a really famous ad that wedged, you know, for the first time, was their first attempt at wedging crime and making white Americans fear black people, right? So the Democrats have been slow on that pivot, but the asymmetry got a lot worse when Republicans realized that the typical model or the original model of electioneering was flawed, because it used to be like when, and it still is, unfortunately, on our side, where you'd go in to manage a campaign and you've got two problems to solve, and they're distinct problems. You've got one thing, you got to turn out your base voters, and you need red meat or whatever special messaging for them to do that, to make them excited. And then you have another bucket, this other group called the swing voters. And what you have to do is get, you know, sell your candidate to them by policy, you know, proximity, moderation, temperament, and biography, right? I was an Air Force pilot. I was a Florida sheriff and I ride a motorcycle, whatever, right? Biography. And in the mid-2000s, Republicans first danced around with the gay marriage bans in 2004, which people who are young will be shocked to hear. In 2004, 11 states were asked, do you want to define marriage between a man and a woman? And even Oregon, all 11 of them passed yes and banned gay marriage.
Yeah, okay? I remember that.
And that ended up defining kind of like the swing bucket message, which was Democrats want to let dogs and cats get married and ruin the sanctity of your marriage. Okay. And they built on that, but really articulated it in 2010 in the midterms. And I want people who are old enough to remember and people who are not to hear it for the first time. In 2009, when Obama comes in, there was like legit talk in the Beltway that the Republican Party would be DOA for decades in Congress.
Because
that had happened previously when the Great Depression happened in Hoover, and people expected, Republicans expected that they were going to be really hurting electorally because of the Iraq war and the economic collapse. Okay. And then yet 1 year, if you go 1 year into that calendar, so November of 2009 to November of 2010, the Republicans pick up 63 seats in the House of Representatives.
Yeah, the shellacking. Right. That was the shellacking.
And so that was the thing that I was literally like first year grad school. I was a non-grad student. I had no mentoring. So I had no idea what I wanted to do my PhD focus on in poli sci. But that's when I started to crystallize for me. Oh, I want to understand that. Like, how does that happen? Because to me, it's a story of strategy and one team's really good at it and the other team isn't.
Right.
And that's kind of like how, you know, I mean, it wasn't a straight path, but if you wanted to like find the through line to how I ended up being who I am today, that would be it. And so I mention all of that because our system has not made that evolution. In 2022, we ran a half, like a bifurcated strategy. There were races in Michigan, in Arizona, mm-hmm. particularly where they ran the strategy this book lays out, which is the Republican strategy, which gets rid of these two universes, these two distinct buckets, and comes up with a emotional framing narrative that both drives a lot of turnout within the people who would vote for you, the Democrats and the independent leaners who will vote for Democrats, mm-hmm. but at the same time is in that persuasion bucket, pushing voters, that swing bucket, away from the Republican brand, okay? So that's like the break the wheel part of this, and it's important for people to understand why that works, which I go into great detail, and it works, folks, because we are kind of freaks when it comes to political interest. Our interest drives our deep reservoir of knowledge because we spend lots of time learning and talking about politics. So we know who all the major players are. We know who Pete Buttigieg is. We know who Kevin McCarthy is, right?
Yes, we do.
But if you think about something you don't like maybe it's opera for you or NASCAR. For me, it's both, right?
Me too. I'm right there with you.
I don't like those things. So I don't know jack shit about either one. I could not tell you one contemporary opera singer's name or one contemporary race car driver's name for that matter. And what folks like us need to understand, especially the people who are doing campaign work, even from grassroots activists to consultants to party chairs, mm-hmm. what we have to understand is that other people have zero interest in politics, and therefore they know that there's a president. They know probably his name is Joe Biden. They know he's a Democrat.
Right.
But once you start getting beyond that, not so much. Okay,
right.
Guys?
And that's the scary thing that people who listen to this show, people who are reading your book, that's part of our group. We know all yes. this stuff, but the majority of people out there don't. And it's
right.
scary. You know, we laugh at the sort of man on the street, you know, Daily Show segments where
right.
they're talking and they don't know anything. That's the American public for the most part.
It is.
They don't
pay
attention.
They're the normal ones and
right.
we're the freaks, okay?
Exactly.
So we've been designing election strategy this whole time like it's a universe full of us. And mm-hmm. so to go back to your intro, which I love,
that was great.
So cute. And anyone who can sing kind of out of tune but still sing publicly, hats off, because I have to do all my singing in my truck.
Me too.
In the country.
In the shower.
So no one can hear me.
That's Lauren Mayer. She does one of those songs a week.
But liked about it is that it was perfect for me to make this particular mm-hmm. point. And she's like, look, like these people are writing our campaign ads ourselves. And I'm adding in an element which says, yes, but normal people will never see that. So we have to make sure we tell them, we bring these headlines to them in our grassroots activism, in our paid media, in the campaign themes that the swing races are running. We need to be telling people the modern Republican Party is an existential threat to you, your
That's
health,
right.
your wealth, your freedom, your security, because they want to get rid of NATO, man. Like, we have to tell the tuned out people what's happening. And I suspect, I don't know, because we've never done it before, but I suspect if we tell them, they're not going to like it.
No, they're not. There's a challenge there, though, in getting them to listen to us telling them what's going on, because there's another faction built into our system of media that is telling them the opposite. And there's a question of dishonest message givers in the media, Fox, Not News, Newsmax, and all the blogs and the right-wing blogosphere that is misinforming people. And so,
yes.
Right, there are all these people out there who don't trust the corporate media, and sometimes that's legitimate. But I forget who it was, because I read a lot of stuff, and it might have been you, it might have been Digby this morning, who said, a Pulitzer Prize winning news organization is not just making shit up.
That's
you know,
me.
Oh, that was you.
You
okay.
can tell because
Thank
of
you.
The shit in the quote.
Right. Well, it could be me too. Right. It's not just making shit up. So you can at least believe the basis of the story. Now, the New York Times does something that you tell them not to do, which is they bend over backwards to do the both-siderism thing,
yes.
or to not appear to be have a liberal bias. Well, you know what? There's an old saying: truth has a liberal bias.
Yeah, yeah.
But you can't get them to admit that because they think they need to bend over backwards to be fair to the people who are lying to us.
Yes, exactly. What happens is I don't use this in the book. I use other things, CRT and
oh,
Bill
yes.
Barr, the Russian collusion. But when you think about how they operate, right? They understand the journalistic norms and ethics of the mainstream system. So it's enough that they have this special ecosystem. And that's a huge problem, a huge asymmetry. And it's not just, spin like it used to be. Now it's flat out mass psychosis causing propaganda pumping out of that. But they also use our system and they understand how to use our system. And they know that some of the training that journalists receive to give, a both sides, like if you're going to get a statement that involves politics, you have to give the opposition a chance to respond. And what Republicans use those opportunities to gaslight, right? And so if you think about, the big lie. When the big lie started, I had been watching the pre-run-up to stealing the election stuff that was happening in plain sight all yeah. through the summer. And I was tweeting, hey, they're doing this thing. They're trying to create this red mirage thing. They're trying to prevent the ballots from getting counted until after the, in-person vote so they can
right.
pretend Trump won. And of course, it all comes to Barr, right? But the worst part for me was that when Trump made his allegations of fraud, the media accepted it as something that they had to report on as it needing to be debunked or verified or, you know what I mean? And by doing so, what they immediately did was legitimize
right.
something we all knew was fake, right? Because he was claiming he was going to claim fraud months in advance and then putting infrastructure in place. And instead of being able to just say that, hey, Trump's claiming it's stolen, but we all watched him do this stuff in real time.
Right.
We treated it like it was something that had to be proven wrong, right? And the consequences of that were January 6th. I mean, obviously, I'm not putting it on the media. The media is a useful idiot in this
yeah,
report,
yeah,
right?
Yeah.
It's Trump and MAGA that caused the insurrection. But at the end of the day, what allowed those people, because many, when I say mass psychosis, folks, I mean it. Like 70 million people in this country are going to vote for a party
yeah.
that is in the process of, in the throes of a cult-like mass psychosis event. And, they if you think about believing the stuff that's Earth 2 reality, that COVID shots kill you, that your blood's tainted forever if you get
right.
one, and that Joe Biden stole the election and this and that, then seizing the Capitol makes sense, right? Like it's a logical thing to do. Holy crap, they've stolen the election. I need to go. So the problem is that media needs to recognize this existential moment for them. The very first people that they're going to come for is the free press.
Yes.
I'm doing a project called Project 1933 this year on my Twitter account, and other people are picking up this content and using it as well. And what it's designed to do is to show people how 1933, the year Hitler was sworn in as a chancellor
right.
into a constitutional separation of power system with a federalist system and a court system and all the stuff, less, institutionalized because it was young, but still it was there, into a cabinet that had just two Nazis on it because the conservatives that brought them to power We're like, hey, you can get some token representation, but you can't actually control the cabinet because we're going to use you, not the other way around. I'm going to walk you guys through 4, 5, 6 months in which one thing after the other, by the time we get into the summer, folks, Dachau, the first concentration camp, is already built and filled with people like us, okay? Yeah, yeah. And journalists, right? Yeah. So like getting media to understand, like your training is what's wrong. It's the same argument I'm having with consultants in the Democratic sphere. Like you've been trained a certain way, but that training is based on this flawed system, flawed understanding of voter behavior and partisanship and all that. It's the same thing for media. And what I think we need to be doing is having very serious conversations in journalist programs and in those professional circuits about the importance of just reporting the truth, right? Just find the truth instead of like making sure everyone is gets a fair shake. Drop that as a strategic focus.
Thank you.
And say, I'm going to go write a story. And what I'm concerned about is finding the truth and the facts, right?
That
and
should be all it is. Facts, who, what, where, when, why? Right, we go right. back if to, we, right?
We can maybe save your, I mean, I'm not saying save us, folks, free press. I'm telling, save you. There, yeah. You are number one target. And even if it's not about like something hyperbolic, like, oh, they're going to put you in a re-education camp. What the Nazis did to quell the free press was they invented the Ministry of Public Enlightenment and Propaganda, yes. Put Joseph Goebbels in it, and then took away ownership or control of all the editorial boards of these publications and forced them to get clearance from the state to publish anything. Oh, and that's very easy to do because at the end of the day, what you'll learn in this project is that all it takes is willingness of an individual with power to say, I am suspending common law, the Constitution, because we have this emergency situation I need to deal with, and a party or a large enough group of people willing to say, okay, let's go do that. Okay. And I would argue Republicans have both.
They do. And they led by Donald Trump, who has already, one, shown us what he would do. I just think back to the day when he crossed the park to the church with the holding the upside down Bible, telling the National Guard or military to clear out the protesters, and thinking this is what he will do if he gets back in there. He's told us. He said he'd suspend the Constitution. So so believe them when they show you who they are the first time, right?
Yeah.
And you, Rachel Bitecofer, again, is our guest. Where she's got a new book out, Hit 'Em Where It Hurts, How to Save Democracy by Beating Republicans at Their Own Game. They've been very good at doing political theater. You know, I've always been a fan of street theater, you know, that's why I love these parody songs, the Lauren Mayer song that I started with, because humor and street theater and drama gets people's attention. That's why Jon Stewart was so good at what he did. I think the jury's still out on his reboot, because I love Jon Stewart, but he's trying to do the both sider thing.
I know.
And
we can't need afford him. It, John.
Right. Stop it. There's nothing redeemable about Trump and what he and the Trump Republican Party has in store for this country if they get him back into the White House. So this is where, and we get your book, you're basically 2/3 of the way in when you say, okay, now let's get down to business and talk about what we do. And you talk about, we discussed this last time you were on, negative partisanship strategy. And they're really good at that. Explain what you mean by negative partisanship.
Yeah, so, you know, I mean, you got a name, if you're taking an electioneering system, a strategy that's existed for decades, and you're saying, actually, let's get rid of that, and here's a new system, you got to name it something.
Right.
And negative partisanship is what allowed me to come into the forecasting and election analysis world and be able to kind of, you know, preempt the boys and the polls and all the models in that 2018 cycle, right? Mm-hmm. So like, you know, what it means is this, we're Democrats, okay? We're all Democrats. We have an identity that's based in that. But because of that, and because of our weird system where there are two things, or not five, there's two,
right?
We have a negative, so we have our positive partisanship, you know, liberals, progressivism, what all of it, all the fuzzy stuff we love. And then we have a negative aspect. So that's what negative partisanship would refer to. And that is the feelings that we feel, the threat, the hate, the fear, that we feel when the opposition party has control over us. Okay? So like the rage that you felt today at the Alabama Supreme Court Republicans who just, you know, terminated IVF, right?
Right. An that embryo, and those who don't know, an embryo is a child, according to the Alabama Supreme Court, in case you missed the story. It's astounding. So
astounding. It's definitely like the most sex that church and state have had in 60 or 70 years in this country. And that includes Dobbs, which was also more bump in the uglies than we would like to see in a country that's supposed to not have church and state connected. Right.
Yep.
So, it's about getting people to respond. So what you're doing is you're exposing the electorate, and this is why you don't need two different messages, because it works across the voter file. That's what I learned in 18, is that independents feel negative partisanship too. They just feel it differently. It's because of the narrative components of, you know, a theme. Oh, Republicans, Donald Trump is bad. Republicans are going to lose the House. Like all that narrative affects the pure independent behavior, but they don't, the Republicans tap into negative partisanship to make swing voters not vote for us. So the way that they're going about a message isn't, hey, I'm Val Demings, I'm a motorcycle cop, I'm going to get shit done, I'm bipartisan, da da da, do do do, I'm going to get you this thing that you like policy wise. Their message in Florida was Val Demings a Democrat. All Democrats are bad. All of them are socialists. They all are pedophiles, and they want to, you know, let brown people come and murder you.
And
right?
Like socialist, 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 socialist. Even though socialist, they don't know what socialist. It means. Right.
Exactly. So, you know, like if you, and when you look at these contests in 22, I said we ran a bifurcated map. So in Michigan and Arizona, that's what they did. They set up in different ways because in Arizona, you had the Secretary of State race against an actual, like, card carrying at the Capitol building insurrectionist who was trying to become the Republican, you know, Secretary of State over and just ruin free and fair elections forever in Arizona. And then in Michigan, you had the three girls. You have the best.
They're the
three
best
politicians together, especially. Like, I just love them. But anyway, what they did so effectively up there was they defined the cycle as Tudor Dixon's Republican. Mm-hmm. Republicans are stealing your freedom and going to kill you with abortion rules, right? And so they did to that swing bucket what I want to do, what I want every swing race in America from state legislature up to do. They made it a referendum on the Republican brand and then painted Republicans with a broad brush and told them, be afraid of the Republicans like they do to us. And that's exactly what allowed us to blunt the red wave significantly. People may see losing the House as a loss. I do, because I know I could have won those Long Island races, right? But at the end of the day, what was accomplished with half of a strategic shift was profound. And now it's about getting everyone to buy in to the rest of it. And that's why I'm so grateful that Jamie Harrison has been so forward. You know, he blurbs the back of the book, tells everybody this is the thing to use. And then he tweeted about it, said the same thing. Every Democrat, every consultant, every candidate, every activist needs to be using this book. And I'm not saying that because I want to sell books to you guys. I mean, that's great. But what I want is you to have this book so we can win in 2024 and save especially the marginalized communities, which I'm arguing, you know, this message right now, we conflate a lot of things with electioneering. And, you know, we go into a race and we're like, okay, we're going to have to win, but we also make sure we have to be diverse. So we have representation. We say pregnant people and not pregnant women and all this other shit. Right. And Republicans are walking in, they're looking at it as a problem to solve. How do I maximize the probability of 51%+ in this race or whatever they need to win? Okay. And that's it. Like, there's no other consideration involved, right? So they're like, okay, well, what if all of us in Virginia, from the state legislature to the AG, to the lieutenant gov, to the governor, all run on something called CRT. CRT is something that didn't even exist prior to this strategy, right?
Right.
But and here's the thing is, like, on that side, there's nobody in there. You will never sell me on Glenn Youngkin, Mr. Sweater Vest, giving two shits about race in school. His thing is definitely economics, fiscal conservatism stuff, right? He's a total business dork. And if he was us, that's what he would have run on, because that's what he likes and he wants to stand run on what he likes.
Right. And what he knows, allegedly. Right.
But since they're Republicans and the consultants, the strategists are like, hey, we found this wedge issue that's highly emotive, especially coming out of the school closure time period. And we're going to wedge it and we're going to run it from the state legislature all the way up. And we're going to create such a cacophony by doing so that the media picks up the narrative and does our work for us. Right. So like getting Democrats to centralize and say, look, I get that your issue is this. Let's run on Roe repeal, on freedom, on threat to democracy, and so they're them stealing people's Social Security and Medicare,
yes,
right? Like that, right. There's a lot of other things we could run on, but let's run on those things because those are the things that are gonna max our probability of winning. And here's the good part, folks, is if you win, you have the political power to deliver for all those other people that you didn't make the campaign about, right? So like I'm keen on representation that matters, representation in the actual, you know, control of government that's going to keep trans people from being targeted by the state of Texas, that's going to keep Latinos from, you know, we're looking at a mass deportation plan to get to, that's going to target the Latino community and just be absolutely brutal, guys, like nothing the free world has seen since Nazi Germany. So it really is about getting us to separate kind of like the passion part of what motivates us from winning and competing for winning elections.
Rachel Bitecofer, there's so much you said there. First, for two things. First of all, when we spoke last time, I was living in Florida. We left Florida. My husband says it's my allergies. I'm allergic to fascism. We moved. We moved to Arizona. So, okay. So it's at least going in the right direction, or it appears to be anyway. But I'm surrounded by these political crazies. But two things. You write in the book a lot. You go through the whole story of how critical race theory became this wedge issue, or wedgie, if you prefer. And you take it back to the beginning when Tucker Carlson had this guy, Christopher Rufo, on his show at the beginning of September of 2020. You can trace it back to that. Nobody ever heard of CRT before
then.
That's
right.
And they blew it up to this huge wedge issue. They're teaching critical race theory in our schools. Well, number one, no, they're not. Number two, what the fuck is critical race theory? You don't even know.
No shit, dude.
Right?
And yet it worked, right? So like, that's what I'm trying to do for us, so we can save everybody. And like, you know, we've got the wildfire problem in 24, folks. So like, if you're one of these, I got to swallow it and vote for Biden because Rachel Bitecofer told me I'm going to die if I don't. And that's not very nice of her to say that. In fact, you know, I don't really love her for it. Fine. Hate me all you want. Vote for Biden. And then here's the thing. If we make these changes, just my life goal is more seats, more power, more of the stuff that we could have had if only Hillary Clinton had won in 2016, because we would have had a liberal Supreme Court majority for the first time in 40 years. And we could have used it to get rid of gerrymandering, to get rid of Citizens United. And that ship has sailed. I mention it because we let our emotions guide too many people, let emotion guide their vote choice in 16. And we cannot afford it this cycle.
Right. And I can even take it back further. I know you can too, but go back to 2000 when the Supreme Court, or as I call them, the extreme court now, decided the race and just handed it to the Republicans all over Florida again. And the Democrats did nothing. And Al Gore said, all right, well, I have to accept the outcome of the election, unlike Trump, who said, even though he lost legitimately, which Al Gore did not, Trump's like, I don't accept that. I didn't lose. They stole it. And he's still doing that to this day.
Yep.
You're not suggesting Democrats go out and lie. You're suggesting they just tout their record and position the Republican Party as what they are today, which is the party of Trump. And you say, even take it further, use the two F words, freedom and fascism. Freedom.
Yeah, exactly. And here's why. So Nicole, you touched on this when I said, what do they say about us? They call us socialist. Okay. Yes. So in our world, like I'll get, you know, I'm rolling this out. I've been rolling it out for a couple of years, but you know, like as I'm rolling it out, I get to have like responses. I learn what, like how people are going to respond. And so one of the things that people respond with or tend to is, well, we can't say something like fascism. Nobody knows what that is. Okay. And so I write in the book, and I'm talking about it here. That's actually good. Okay. Nobody knew what CRT was either. And we got a lot of pleasure out of laughing, right? When they would go to the event and they'd be like, I'm so concerned about CRT. And then the reporter would be like, well, what is CRT? And the guy would be like, I have no idea, but it sounds really bad, right?
It's race. They're teaching race.
So like Republicans never taught America what socialism means.
No.
They just told them that we are socialist and they infer it's bad. That's like, it's the, in fact, that an inferential process allows each end user, the recipient of the target, you know, to internalize, kind of make up their own perfect fitting shoe of what this scary thing is. What's important is the association, scary thing, Republican,
right?
Scary thing, Republican, like it's how they do to us, right?
That's right.
So, you know, we have to say, right now we're starting in a huge deficit, and you know the Republicans have been running that socialist theme since the Tea Party. Really, they went balls to the wall against Obama, and that was where it started. So like that thing has percolated really deep, and we are not going to be able to equalize it, but that doesn't mean we can just ignore it and not try. We have to start calling them fascist. We have to make sure people associate the word fascist, which they don't know what it is, but it sounds bad, with the Republican Party.
Right. And just their policies. But you need to make that association.
Rachel, but you also, Nicole, I just want to be clear. You can't just say, you know, that Congress won't let us have guns, right? You have to name the villain. So like we read things and it says the NRA is killing our kids. And we know that that actually means Republicans too. But people who know nothing don't know that. Okay.
Right.
So what we've created, and this is actually kind of good. I mean, you know, it didn't work the way we wanted to, but it has provided us this new strategy launching pad where public opinion is way on our side. Okay. Like we don't need to convince America anymore that we need gun legislation, that, you know, all these things they pull up in the 70s and 80s. What we need to do now is do what they do and make sure that when somebody thinks high minimum wage, they think Democrats. When they think legal pot, they think Democrats. When they think climate change legislation, they think Democrats, because we haven't done that by diluting who the villain is, by not credit claiming everything and making sure, you know, that if we're tweeting out about something that amazing that happened that all Democrats voted for and no Republicans or even maybe one or two did, we have to tell people, hey, we can't say Congress passed $35 insulin.
Right.
We have to say Democrats passed $35 insulin and every Republican voted no, right?
Right.
We have to do that.
Same thing with the infrastructure bill, right? You have all these Republicans going out to the ribbon cutting ceremonies where they're repairing or building a new bridge. We need to make it clear that person voted against this legislation. If it was up to him or her, you wouldn't have this bridge or dam or...
That's exactly right.
And that's what they're not doing. Look, Donald Trump was great. Still is. He's the best at patting himself on the back, taking credit for things that he had nothing to do with. But he'd tell you over and over again, he's the best at it. It can't be done without him. And right, if the Democrats get in power again, they'll destroy it all. Well, we need to take it a step further and say the things that are true and point out where they're lying and how it's the opposite of what they're saying, right?
And in terms of like Trump, okay, so here's the thing. Like if you ask swing voters, like the true pure independents, not the leaners I talk about in the book, you know, they'll tell you the Trump economy was hot. And how did they know? Because Donald Trump told them every day it was not.
He told them he had the best economy in the world, which we do right now.
Exactly.
Where is Joe
Biden?
He didn't say,
I know some of you are still suffering, or I know there's still work to do. No, guys. I mean, I realize like in your survey focus group, experimental research, people don't like to be told that they should be happy. But in the real world, at the aggregate, public opinion is framed from the top down.
That's right.
Not always. There are things that belie that. Gay marriage legalization is one of them. The public opinion got way ahead of the politicians on that. But generally speaking, you can make the public have an impression. And that's what, if I had to sum up what the Republicans do well, it's they use their electioneering and their media system together to do that, to tell the public what to think about it, right? It's narrative framing, and it recognizes the low level of civic knowledge and the reservoir of mostly imagistic observation of the political system that, you know, and that's why their obstruction strategy always works. So
it works.
Yes, they killed border security third time in 20 years. But if you ask voters, I guarantee you they're going to blame Joe Biden.
Right. Joe Biden didn't get it done. Well, excuse me, they just voted it down, and then they impeached the Secretary of the Homeland Security for not getting it done.
Yes. And the thing is that no one's going to know that if we don't attack them for voting, that Republicans voted for open borders. You know, it's the Republican, it's Donald Trump's border crisis now, dude. Right.
Right.
So we. Yeah,
and things like they tell you one thing, but they do the opposite. They tell you they're for border security. They were given the opportunity to pass the most stringent border security bill in a generation or more, and they wouldn't even bring it to a vote. They
because
tell
Donald
you one
Trump
thing,
told them because, no,
exactly.
So that he could run on it. For a year,
because
for
he wants it to be an issue. Yeah. You know, we need to point out I just got to play this clip. I think I have it up here. A little quick thing from CNN. I think it was today.
What we've learned is that President Biden himself personally instructed some of his top campaign aides to be even more aggressive in highlighting some of President Trump's more inflammatory and wild comments. We are told that the thrust of the president's direction was to significantly ramp up the campaign's efforts to highlight the crazy shit that Trump says in public.
The crazy shit that Trump says in public. She said that on CNN. So
yeah, I know. That was great.
Right. So, but because that's what it is. It is crazy shit. Now, we also got to say that this.
I love the poorly educated.
When Trump said, I love the poorly educated, was probably not a misspeak. He does.
No, it was the most honest thing he's ever said.
That's
probably,
right.
Dude.
Because you point out something in the book, which is a study about the way in 2016, the way the candidates were perceived, and Donald Trump, the analysis of his speech patterns and words he used, the best words, only the best. He speaks at a level that a fourth grader can understand.
But and that's the American public, dude.
That is the American public.
I mean, I'm not, I don't want to be the bearer of bad news. I know liberals like to think everybody's fuzzy and warm, whatever, and nobody would be bad if only they had love and support or whatever. But like the end of the day, folks, the most important thing I'm doing in my work is getting the public, the election world, the campaigns, whatever, to catch up to something that political science knew for 70 years, okay? As soon as survey research was invented, nerds like me were like, hey, now we can learn things about voters. Let's go do studies. And they did. And what they figured out was actually no Americans know jack shit about anything going on in politics. And this was probably better back then, guys. It's gotten worse because of all the choice we have now in terms of what we spend our time watching.
Right.
So they figure it out that actually beyond like who's the president, as I said, who's the president, maybe some broad understanding of like the three branches thing. They
don't understand anything. But most can't name the three branches of government.
Half of them can't even do that. But even the ones that could may not be able to explain very much about it, right? And so, so then they argue, but don't worry, America, it's okay. Because it turns out voters are using a cheat that is actually very useful for them to engage in, to make smart decisions on behalf of democracy, but without knowing a damn thing about it, right? And they said, look, partisanship, it's this, people use that as a shortcut, so I don't need to know anything about John Smith. I know he's a Republican, I'm a Republican, good, boom, right? And so that's always been the case in our system, folks, but the GOP started to manipulate that, as I said, when they recognized the power of this new strategy that I'm trying to transition us to. And partisanship, although always strong, is 100% stronger now. It dictates everything. I don't need to know anything about you. I don't need to know any of your demographics that the analysts are always focused on. Man, woman, you know, rural, urban, educated, not black, white, whatever, right? I don't need to know any of that. What I need to know is, are you a Democrat or a Republican or an independent who, when asked, says, I lean towards the Democratic Party or I lean towards the Republican Party?
Right.
Because I can predict your vote choice a year away from an election, okay, with no particular candidates, just based on party label. That's how powerful partisanship is. It's at the end of the day, you are going into a ballot box that's going to have an R and a D.
Mm-hmm.
And what we need to be doing is selling that D.
Right.
You can't escape it. If you try, all you do is reinforce the opponent's argument that there's something wrong with Democrats. Okay.
Exactly.
And here's the thing. It's actually a really good brand. Like, it created the entire American middle class. It gave you Social Security and Medicare. It is the only party standing up for democracy and rule of law. It should be. And our economic program, by the way, has helped steer America through two major economic catastrophes and is now produced the best economy in the fucking world. So we have a good brand. Stop letting them put you into a defensive posture. They're going to attack you and connect you to the squad, and you can't change that. So you have to have a strategy that sells the brand, rides for the brand, our brand up, their brand down, and hits them where it hurts.
One of my favorite parts of the book, Rachel Bitecofer, is when you talked about the Senate race last year, or in the last election, and you talked about, well, first of all, it was you talked about the apologetic Democrats, Tim Ryan running in Ohio, saying, but, you know, I work with the other side. I don't like the squad. I'm more centrist, and I'll work with the Republicans. Stop it. Val Demings, you just mentioned, did it as well. I'm a Democrat, but I'm not one of those Democrats. Stop it. The Democrats are the reason we have all these things you list on page 80 and 81. You say anyone who questions the record of Team Blue over the past century, keep this list handy. Someone should make up cards so we can have them in our pocket and say, look what the Democrats did. The Democrats are responsible for. You need ammunition to fight back against these people, and we don't need any more apologetic Democrats.
No, no.
I knew them.
And
minute-
to be clear, those three candidates, it's easy to say it's the candidate, but it's like with Hillary Clinton in 16, the three candidates, what they're relying on is advice of consultants.
Of course.
And the consultants run the campaign. That's why it's so important to me to reach these folks and be like, look, it's not that they aren't excellent at what they're doing. They're excellent at what they're doing. What I'm arguing is, though, it's the wrong thing to be doing, and we should do this other thing that they'll also be excellent at.
Right.
I don't want to take your clients. I just want you to do it this way so that we all live, because at the end of the day, Tim Ryan, Val Demings, Sherry Beasley in North Carolina, those are three seats that if we had right now, guys, you know, right?
I mean, we needed them
and we could have had them all. Here, the electorate in Ohio went in and they voted for J.D. Vance, okay? And they did it a lot because it's de-aligning from the Democrats to the Republicans. So that R brand next to his name, for a lot of the people who clicked it, it signified limited government, good on the economy, good on national defense. And you and all and I all know, okay? We all know. But again, if you don't read or watch any news, you do not know that.
Right.
Okay? It's the old brand of the Republican Party. And not once did the Ryan campaign tell the electorate J.D. Vance is a MAGA extremist that's going to pass a national abortion ban.
Right.
That's going to come for your Social Security and your Medicare. Right. Like, we have to do that for the electorate that's tuned out, because they don't already know that. It's the idea that they already know the Republican Party is extremist. No, they don't. And they don't. We have to be the ones to tell them.
Right, because they're watching Fox and they're not hearing all the bad shit that's going on. They're
not even those folks, because keep in mind, Fox's audience
right.
is like
they're also political people. Okay? Right. It's people who aren't hearing any of it.
Anything. They aren't hearing anything. And when I say anything, I mean it. I mean, if you're a certain age and me and Nicole are, you've lived two lives, the pre and post internet life, okay?
Oh, yeah.
Pre-internet, you couldn't avoid, to some extent, political news. You would see it on because there was only certain many channels. Everyone had to watch the commercials. You got the nightly news with the primetime Dallas, whatever, right? You saw people walking by with newspapers, sitting in diners. Everyone talked to each other because we had nothing better to do than to get to know each other. And like now, that's not the case. So a lot of people have never heard the things that you know and don't get down in the weeds about it. Top level, they're going to ban abortion nationwide. They're talking about stealing your Social Security. They're an extremist movement that doesn't believe in the Constitution and has a transition model or manual from democracy to autocracy, and what that means for you, voter. Okay.
Right.
It's your kids, your house, your wealth, your freedom. And if we do that, I think we can put out the wildfire that this cycle represents, because we're in a wildfire situation, but we have climate change. We have a civic culture and a democracy that's on its deathbed. And we have to be assuming we're going to put out the wildfire and deal with the climate change. And if we do that and we start educating the public about what's going on, we are going to see, I hope, some real progress on the issues that matter to progressives.
Oh, I so hope so. Now, you also have, again, the book is about messaging, because it's I see a little boy in the background.
That's my special little dude.
It's adorable.
He just got home from school. Sorry.
That's okay. No, I love it. Kids and dogs. Hi. Kids and animals make my day. All right. So you have 7 steps to improve democratic messaging, to help the average person, the listener of the show, who's got to sit, you know, over family dinner with some people who may not be as well informed as they are. So you have 7 steps. Step 1 is ride for the brand. You've been talking about the brand the whole time. Reinforce the brand. The Democratic brand is a pretty damn good one.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
Exactly.
Number 2, rebrand both parties with F words. We talked about that. Freedom and fascism. Love that. Step 3 is less defense, more counter offense. Yeah. Paint them the picture of what they are, because a lot of people don't know.
Yeah. And that, and they want us to have, they want us to do our campaigns on what they benefits them, immigration, whatever, crime, inflation. What we ought to be doing is making, forcing them to play on our field, right? So we're hitting them on abortion, Roe, Social Security, Medicare, whatever it is. They either have to ignore those attacks and let them go unanswered, or they're going to have to come and answer them.
Right.
Let's make them answer us.
Right. That's sort of step 5. Own our issues, then own theirs. Right?
Exactly. Especially things like when Republicans say something stupid like protect kids. Oh, if you say that around me and you're a Republican, dude, you're going to hear about guns.
Oh,
you're gonna,
please.
You're going to sit there with a straight face and tell me you care about protecting children when I got to send my little off every day. I tell him I love him because I don't know if he's going to come home, right? Like, no way are you getting away with it. And so, yeah, that's what we need to be doing.
And we skipped over step 4. Take credit. Give blame. Take credit for what they've done. Joe Biden, I think, is trying, but he needs to get out there more and take credit for this great economy. Take credit for basically ending the COVID, pulling us out of that and having a soft landing. Take credit for the infrastructure. Everything he's done, you know, Republicans are still saying, oh, Biden hasn't done anything. He's stuck in his basement. Bullshit. That's bullshit.
Yeah, it is bullshit.
Right? So we need to call it out.
we do.
Step 6, stick to a single villain. And in this case, it's the Republican Party under Donald Trump.
Don't say NRA, big pharma, big oil. I mean, you're going to say that. You got to say Republicans. The problem is, Republicans will not allow us to pass this legislation, right? So Republican, Republican, Republican. And that brings you to step 7, which is
say
repetition.
Again and again and again and again.
Again and again, like CRT. Yep.
Exactly. You know, you mentioned before you went into the whole section on CRT, which everyone needs to read, Benghazi. Well, Benghazi is how they tanked Hillary Clinton, with a little assist from, you know, the FBI with James Comey. But still, Benghazi, I did a show. I called Benghazi Tourette's because I was on the air back then. It was Benghazi. Think about it. Four people were killed. It's a tragedy, no matter how you look at it.
But in the 80s, the Beirut, Lebanon embassy bombing killed 180.
Right.
Half of you were active military, right? So, like, yes, it was a tragedy, but it was always exploited. It was never warranted, the what happened with it. Yeah.
And how about the, you know, under Trump, remember the four soldiers killed in Niger?
Yeah. And if that happened, so like Republicans, remember they brought the dead security officer's mom to the convention. Hillary Clinton killed my son. I mean, with Benghazi, just since you mentioned it, folks, I mean, yes, James Comey did not help. But the fact is, the Republicans deployed the Benghazi strategy in 2014, understanding Hillary Clinton was the front runner and almost certain be the nominee in 2016. They do long-term strategic planning. It's something we got to start doing.
Exactly. And Kevin McCarthy even admitted it. I'm not going to play the clip because they've heard it a million times, but we've heard it. He's like, see, now her poll numbers are way down.
Yeah.
Right.
That was the point, right?
Right. And you also talk about your three-step formula: pivot, mock or belittle, and then use a counteroffensive attack to underscore that second point. Can you illustrate that?
Yeah, so I mean, it's exactly what we're talking about in terms of narrative setting. And just ignore my little cameraman because he's fun back there.
We love watching.
So then when they go into a media appearance on Meet the Press, Chris Christie is a great example of this because he's expert at it, okay? They aren't going to have a substantive conversation about a policy issue they care about and, you know, inform the American public. That's what we do, but that's not what they do.
No.
Okay. They show up with talking points and a narrative they're trying to pound, and they're going to get that out. And if someone asks them about this thing, what they're going to do is pivot and attack the Democrats, right? So, you know, how do you feel about Donald Trump telling NATO, you know, telling Russia to go ahead and have NATO.
Right? Anybody who doesn't pay us, attack them.
Yeah. And instead of defending Trump, they pivot and attack us on something, right? Mm-hmm. The immigration thing or whatever. So it's about getting people to understand that they're feeding us bait. Okay. Don't take the treat.
Right.
Go in. If you're getting an opportunity for eyeballs, because so many people are tuned out, then you must use that to narrative set and to shape public opinion. Democrats good, Republicans bad. So instead of having a substantive conversation, when they serve you up something like protect kids, why do you want kids to read porn in school? Say, oh, you want to talk about kids in school?
Yeah, right. Like,
you know what I mean? And then you pivot and you go into the attack. The book lays out kind of the steps to how to do that. Teach yourself how.
Right. And there we have some good practitioners of it. I think Jamie Raskin is great because
he's wonderful.
But last time I mentioned this as well, the best example of this, of a Democrat using the pivot and the, you know, I think still goes back to 2015, then Congressman Alan Grayson, who went on the floor of the House and did this.
I still think that's the best message ever.
Republicans' health care plan for America: don't get sick. That's right. Don't get sick. If you have insurance, don't get sick. If you don't have insurance, don't get sick. If you're sick, don't get sick. Just don't get sick. That's what the Republicans have in mind for you, America. That's the Republicans' health care plan.
Okay.
But I think that the Republicans understand that that plan isn't always going to work. It's not a foolproof plan. So the Republicans have a backup plan in case you do get sick. If you get sick in America, this is what the Republicans want you to do. If you get sick, America, the Republican health care plan is this: die quickly.
Die quickly.
The Republicans want you to die.
So perfect. So
like
perfect.
If I was me back then, you know, I got to tell you, I would have ran the end. I wanted to run on Obamacare. I wanted to take Obamacare from a defensive posture. And this is when, I mean, I had no idea I'd be ever in a position now to do stuff like this. But this is when I was like, you guys at home, arm couch, you know, grad student trying to be like, God, why are we doing it like this? run on Obamacare and tell people the Republican plan for you is don't get sick, and if you do, die quickly. It was perfect messaging, not an imperfect messenger. Okay, I'll give you that. But still, perfect message.
Exactly. So we need more of that. And it's up to every one of us. The polls. One last thing. The polls. It is now February 21st. Election day is a good 9 months away. What do the polls tell us right now?
So the you guys would have to understand about off-year polling is that it's almost always against the incumbent, okay? Because people don't know anything about the government. They never are happy because we're Americans, okay?
Right.
And we don't tell, I mean, we are living through the best period of humanity ever in the history of the world. There is no peoples other than people in the, you know, maybe in Europe who have a little bit better than us, Canada and Europe, but there's no people that have ever had as much freedom, wealth. I mean, we have so much food, we get fat, dude.
Hello.
Like for most of the human experience, calories have been scarce, not surplus, right?
Mm-hmm.
And yet we're miserable people, right? We're miserable people. And it's, and we always, you know, so the polls, what I'm telling people to do is look at the signal. The signal is the special elections, the 2022 midterm where we ran good strategy, the state legislative cycle that we just had in Virginia in 2023, where we flipped back control of the House of Delegates to Democrats, cleaning it up in New York again, you know, like we are winning where we take in competitive elections, where we take this messaging. We are winning, and so I have high hopes, but I mean, there's nothing I can do to relieve folks of this basic fact. We are in a country where the population is deeply divided, especially once you get it down into these swing maps, not divided so much in at the aggregate, but in this weird electoral college system, which is a fact that we can't change. It's there. It's going to make seven states matter. It's going to mean those margins are going to be 100,000 votes or less. And at the end of the day, we're going to make it very clear, I hope, in the messaging from Biden all the way down, what's at stake in this cycle and what the threat of fascism means for people. But I still think that half of the country is going to vote for it. And people need to be prepared for that reality. It's going to be very close. There's not going to be some landslide. Like I knew there wouldn't be a landslide in 2020 either. The electorate's not capable of that. And a lot of Americans, now that they're being confronted because Trump's so sloppy and talks about being a dictator in public, when they're asked, they're like, yeah, sounds good to me. And that's just the harsh reality that we're facing. And there's no way but through, but we can do this. The only thing that will prevent us from winning in 2024 is ourselves.
There you go. And it's up to us. And we now have a guidebook. I'm telling you, you must read this. It's called Hit 'Em Where It Hurts, How to Save Democracy by Beating Republicans at Their Own Game. We're talented. We're smart. We know how to do this. And Rachel lays it out for us. So get the book. It's that good. And I love your son. He's adorable.
He's a budding cameraman, my son.
I love it.
So.
That's awesome. Rachel Bitecofer, thank you so much. Thank you for writing this. Thank you for joining us today. I hope we'll
Thanks
talk again.
Thanks for having me, Nicole.
Anytime. And we, you know, look, we got one job to do. What's his name?
His name is Gabriel.
Gabriel. Hi, yeah. Gabriel. I love you. You're adorable. You're teaching him young, and that's what we must do. Indoctrinate the youth. Sorry, I didn't mean to do that. But get out there and talk to people. We are our own best advocates to keep fascism from taking over this country. Rachel Bitecofer, thank you so much.
Thanks for having me.
My pleasure.
Bye.
Take care.
Bye.
Bye, Gabriel. All right, with that, we're done. We're done for a Tuesday, Wednesday. It's Wednesday. Tomorrow's Thursday. Howie Klein is here. Friday, Marcy Wheeler. I don't know about you, but I think we kind of hit it out of the ballpark with guests this week between Jonathan Larson and the fucking news on Monday. We had Lisa Graves yesterday, Rachel Bitecofer today, Howie Klein tomorrow, Marcy Wheeler Friday. Let me throw out one more thing. I have a mailing address again, finally, that works. So I know some people who sent me letters or checks, got them returned because I couldn't get the post office box working. I have one now. It's on, just go to contact us at NicoleSandler.com or click on the donate page, and the snail mail address is there as well. I depend on your generosity for my income. So you know, if you enjoy the show and think that there's value here and can support our work, my work, I hope you will. With that, we're done. Thank you for listening, everybody. Have a wonderful, wonderful night. And is the book available on Audible? It absolutely is. It's, you know, it's a major release. It's through the publisher's is Penguin House, I believe. It is, you know, it's Crown Penguin, Crown Publishing, which is part of Penguin Random House. Just like the music industry, the publishing industry is like there's three publishers who own them all. But this is one of the biggies. And I hope more people, I hope everybody picks up this book. It's really that good. And as you can tell, I'll have to send Rachel a picture with all my little Post-its. We could have talked for hours. I could have gone through this. It's that good. It's that readable. Okay. With that, I'm late. We're done. I'll see you tomorrow. Peace out. Vote Democratic.